Well, good morning, everyone, and happy Valentine's Day. Welcome to this science seminar brought to you by the Southeast Climate Adaptation Science Center, also known as the SE CASC, you'll see on the screen, or Southeast CASC. So my name is Carrie Furness, and I'm the Assistant University Director here at the Southeast CASC, and I'm joined today by Ryan Boyles, who is the Deputy USGS Director also for the center. So in these virtual seminars, we're highlighting SE CASC funded projects that support resource management actions across the Southeast. And today we're excited to highlight several new projects that have recently been initiated. So let me start with letting you know what to expect from today's webinar. So first we'll go over some quick meeting logistics, get some quick feedback via a poll, and then we're going to launch into our lightning talks. And so each of these project PIs will be, will one by one give some information about their project in a 5-minute lightning talk. And then we'll have some Q&A and discussion with all the researchers at the end of those presentations before we wrap up. So now let me just give you a quick overview of our webinar technology, which many of you I know are very familiar with, but just so we're all on the same page. The unmute button and video button is at the bottom left of your Zoom screen. Ask that you keep your video off to lessen distractions, and then stay muted until we get to the Q&A, and then we can you can raise your hand and we'll call on you to ask your question. You can see the chat is in your bottom bar. I would recommend you go ahead and if questions come up during presentations, go ahead and throw your questions in there, and we will be monitoring those and pose them at the end. So we're also recording this webinar, and actually we'll be posting some clips on project pages as a result of this, but you can find those on our Southeast CASC website, on our Science Seminars webpage, and our YouTube channel. So now I'd like to just launch a short poll, just to sort of get a bit of information about who's with us, might help our presenters know who they're talking to, and also how you've learned about these seminars, which helps us know how to get the word out. So it looks like, oh, got a fair number of federal agencies, universities, close running there. And thank you for reading our newsletter and passing the word along. So I'll go ahead and end that, share the results real quick. And then, yeah, all right. I think this sets us up for a nice discussion at the end. So, all right. So now I'll go ahead and turn the microphone over to Ryan Boyles, who's going to introduce our PIs and their projects.
Thank you, Carrie. So I'm so excited to have this group of PIs here who are going to give quick introductions to 7 newly initiated SE CASC projects. They're going to introduce themselves and then dive into a little bit of the details of their current research, including sort of the expected results and the management implications for what they're doing, knowing that, of course, this is all research. We can't predict exactly how it'll turn out, but they are looking at directions and the specific types of questions they're trying to answer. So first up, we have Robert Scheller and Samuel Flake from NC State University introducing their project titled Informing Climate Adaptive Forest Management for Breeding Bird Habitat in the Southern Appalachians.
Great, thanks and good morning. I'm Rob Scheller from College of Natural Resources. My collaborators are Dr. Sam Flake, who'll jump in here in a second, and Dr. Tina Mozalewski. She's at Conservation Science Partners in California. Both of them were SE CASC fellows. So super effective program, and thank you for that. So our project is building on a lot of other projects that we have going on in the Southern Appalachians. We're forecasting the future of the Southern Appalachians and trying to understand how wildfire and climate change and management will all interact on this incredibly diverse region. And particularly for this project, we're going to zoom in on birds and bird habitat. How will future disturbances, future climate change alter the availability of that habitat? And so now I'm going to turn it over to Sam.
Thanks, Rob. So the Southern Appalachians are a super complex place, and these birds of greatest conservation need are also a really diverse bunch of birds. They need, some of them need old growth, some of them need early successional open habitats. And so a really good tool to help sort of understand how all these different processes are interacting is a forest landscape model that simulates forest growth and tree mortality and tree establishment and disturbances like wildfire or bark beetles. And so, like Rob mentioned, we've developed this model for the Southern Appalachians. We're building on that past work. And what we're doing is, on top of that model, modeling the suitability of those forests for bird habitat. And this would have been a really difficult task until recently. So we've got some really good new tools like JEDI, which is satellite sensed LIDAR, which helps us model forest biomass both vertically and horizontally. And so that allows us to generate bird habitat models that can respond dynamically to what the forest landscape model is doing. So if, say, there's a silvicultural treatment that we're implementing in the model, it'll get translated to the bird habitat model. And so using these two sets of models, the goal of this project is to forecast, you know, what are the projected changes in bird habitat, and also what are some of the management alternatives that our partners can use to try and improve, you know, those trajectories of habitat. So that might be simulating different silvicultural treatments and helping to prioritize, you know, where they are, the intensity, the temporal scale, or maybe the distribution of prescribed fire throughout the landscape. And maybe to the next slide. And so, yeah, our biggest goal of this project is to do some experiments with those alternatives to help our partners at Appalachian Mountain Joint Venture, the North Carolina Wildlife Resource Center, or sorry, Resource Commission, the Nature Conservancy, other partners, to evaluate how these sort of like experimental silviculture that's been going on at a fine scale, how that scales up to a regional scale and interacts with climate and disturbance on long time scales. And we also hope to use the forest landscape model and the bird habitat models to help identify, you know, what are the greatest threats to some of these species. Is it changes in forest structure due to, say, fire suppression, or is it maybe it's changes in disturbance regimes and large wildfires might be the biggest threat. And so learning something about what potential treatments we might use to help adapt or mitigate those changes. And then lastly, we're building on a huge active collaborative environment around this forest modeling software. And also a really active group of researchers in Southern Appalachians from NC State and Forest Service, Nature Conservancy. And so you can draw in some of the new research that they're doing on management in the Appalachians, draw that into our work, and then hopefully contribute our work back into that, that ecosystem. And so, yeah, we're excited to see the future of this project and also the future of breeding birds in the Appalachians. Thanks.
We're excited too. Thank you, Rob and Sam. Next up, we have Simeon Europe from US Geological Survey. He's introducing a project in which he's the PI, titled Water, Water Everywhere, Adapting Water Control Operations and Floodplain Conservation Planning to Global Change.
Hi, thanks, Ryan. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. So the challenge, climate change is altering precipitation and stream flow regimes globally. We're working in the Roanoke River Basin in North Carolina. For this basin in particular, spring floods are occurring earlier in the year, and recent flood events have been kind of in the top tier of historic flows. So the U.S. Army Corps must manage these flows dynamically, which is input and output across the reservoirs, to meet multiple objectives for humans and ecosystems. Ecological flows are one of their objectives, but there are risks of triggering flood and drought stages. So managers at the Corps would like to know if recent hydrologic trends are a blip on the radar or if they're here to stay. In terms of conservation, the Nature Conservancy must identify optimal locations for restoration and conservation work downstream of the reservoir. And fish and wildlife agencies must decide how to best manage aquatic populations and forest floodplain ecology. So our results, we begin developing structured decision-making products that include objectives hierarchy tables, consequences and trade-offs analyses, and risk assessment. And we'll do this using the PROACT method developed by Hammond, Keeney, and Rifa. Trends analysis, we're analyzing the historic stream flow period of record data for common hydrologic metrics. These include frequency of high inflow events, durations such as consecutive weeks above a threshold or increases in a trend over time. And we're also considering minimum flow release types of metrics such as 7Q10. PRMS, this is the USGS precipitation runoff modeling system developed by Jacob LaFontaine et al. We are reviewing the latest national scale release and ground truthing for our study area. And Charlie Stillwell at SAUSE is going to be doing a large part of that review. So kudos to Charlie. One issue here is that the land use model in PRMS does not account for reservoir management. So we are looking for potential post calibrations that can be made to PRMS. Hydrologic modeling, we're using the Army Corps' HEC modeling suite to compare alternative water management plans, both as hindcast and forecast, using PRMS conditions. So this is a type of common garden experimental design that examines how water control management may perform under altered climate regimes. Climate scenarios, we'll be applying the scenarios developed in PRMS. We still have to decide which ones, but the idea here is to arrive at an estimate of uncertainty of stream flow input into CAR reservoir that the Corps manages. Ecological modeling, the Nature Conservancy will be applying an ecosystem function model that they've developed. This focuses on forest floodplain ecology, and the goal is to better understand how extended durations of floodplain inundation impact forest ecology. And then finally, migratory fish passage, will be comparing how aquatic habitat connectivity may change under alternative future scenarios. And then moving on to impact, the focus here is risk management. For ecoflows, water control, the concern is that these ecoflows are needed when hydrology is trending toward the extremes, either toward flood or drought. However, the ecoflows practices could exacerbate conditions. For example, water is held in storage to source the flows, but if releases are insufficient during drought or if inflows to the reservoir are excessive during flood, management action could actually tip the system across the critical threshold. So the water managers want to get a better sense of what their risk is. And this is particularly difficult with large confidence intervals on the predicted precipitation regime. So risk management for conservation, floodplain connectivity is a big concern here. The Nature Conservancy is investing to restore connectivity between the main stem river and back swamps. However, there's uncertainty in how managed river flows translate to spatial extent of floodplain inundation. So they don't want to restore areas that may not receive floodwaters. And that is a decision-making risk for them. And then finally, tribes. We're building on Nature Conservancy's engagement with North Carolina tribes in the Roanoke Basin to better understand how they are impacted by climate change and river management. And if appropriate, we'll develop applications of our water and ecological modeling to focus on important resources for tribes. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Good stuff. Thank you, Dr. Yurick. Our next presenter is Dr. Erin Seacamp from NC State University. She'll be introducing the project titled Examining Diverse Management Objectives and Broadening Stakeholder Engagement for Climate Adaptation Planning of Historic Structures within the National Park Service.
Thanks, Ryan, and thank you for joining the seminar today. This project is an ongoing effort that started with an initial project, a pilot project that was funded by the Southeast CASC. That was at Cape Lookout, and then it was funded by the National Park Service Climate Change Response Program to test its transferability at Gulf Islands National Seashore, and now we're returning with some new funding from the Southeast CASC to really focus on expanding the model and thinking a little bit more broader about how to integrate values into this. I have collaborators at Arizona State University at Hainan campus, Dr. Zhao Zhao with USGS, Dr. Mitch Eaton, and at the Water Institute of the Gulf, Dr. Supi Daliander. We also work in collaboration with Rob Young and his group at Western Carolina University, who has developed coastal adaptation and vulnerability modeling for the National Park Service's coastal units. And so we utilize information that deals with these properties that are listed on the National Register of Historic Places and think about how to create transparent adaptation decisions that are informed by the people whose heritages are tied to them. So at Cape Lookout National Seashore, there's two historic villages, Portsmouth Village and Cape Lookout Village, both of which are listed at the district level on the National Register of Historic Places. And so when we first went, we tested on 17 buildings. This time we'll be using the full complement of structures in those villages. We're also going to be learning from impacts that were sustained during Hurricane Dorian to advance the vulnerability assessments, as well as the adaptation options available to the National Park Service. And so we do this by using an optimization model that has an objective function that now integrates weighted objectives following a co-production process with our partners with the National Park Service, the NC State, the North Carolina State Historic Preservation Office, the Friends of Portsmouth Island, and the Core Sound Waterfowl Museum and Heritage Center. We're also going to be thinking a little bit more broadly about those stakeholder values and adaptation preferences by conducting online elicitations with the membership space of those two partner organizations to weight the adaptation options in our model. And so what it allows us to do is think about the complex trade-offs that are given under various types of budget constraints, and then thinking about at what point to let go is the best option, particularly as we're now going to be integrating storm modeling events with the help of Supi Daliander working to integrate that into the algorithm itself. And so the model works in a way that you have a set budget constraint for an annual budget allocation over 30 years. Every structure has a historic value that's assessed through either existing data within the National Park Service's databases or through expert opinion, as in the people who are managing those structures, as well as their potential for use and how that changes with adaptation options available to them, or either positively or negatively enhancing the historic value and use potential. And then that's divided by the vulnerability assessment that's conducted for each building itself. And the optimization model goes through a dynamic process to integrate how adaptation actions influence both the historic value use potential, as well as the vulnerability assessment, to come up with a pattern of actions that are applied across the landscape for the buildings. And so how can we learn from borrowing money for some structures, annual maintenance, to apply more costly adaptation actions, and which of these adaptation actions are most preferable to the local community. So thank you very much. I appreciate your time today.
Thank you, Dr. Seacamp. I know that work has been really impactful so far. Really excited to see these next steps. Now we have Laura DeCunto from U.S. Geological Survey introducing her project entitled Integrated Sea Level Rise Scenarios into Everglades Restoration Planning.
Great, thank you, Ryan. So as you all just heard, I'm Laura DeCunto. I'm an ecologist at the USGS Wetland and Aquatic Research Center. My co-PIs for this project include Stephanie Romaniak, a research ecologist at the USGS Wetland and Aquatic Research Center, and Maisha Clark, an assistant professor at the University of Florida School of Forest, Fisheries, and Geomatic Sciences. So restoration of the Everglades is one of the largest and most expensive restoration efforts in the world. And its position in southern and coastal Florida make it particularly susceptible to climate change impacts, such as sea level rise. So we're working with a multi-agency team known as RECOVER, which is short for Restoration, Coordination, and Verification. And this entity is responsible for providing technical information to the decision makers who implement specific parts of the comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan. RECOVER contains representatives from multiple federal, state, and tribal entities that you can see here on the slide, who have expertise in Everglades restoration. So this project is focused on finding ways to integrate consideration of sea level rise scenarios into the current processes that RECOVER uses to provide technical support for decision makers and planners implementing Everglades restoration. Next slide, please. Our anticipated results include the identification of restoration questions that need to consider sea level rise, which we will determine using focus groups, interviews, and survey questions that are developed by my co-PI, Maisha Clark, who is a social scientist with expertise in these methods. We will then work with RECOVER to develop information on the process of choosing relevant sea level rise scenarios for the unique projects being considered. Finally, we will provide methodology on how to incorporate sea level rise scenarios into the current ecological models that we use, that are used in RECOVER's technical evaluations, and that are provided to those implementing restoration efforts. So this will also include an iterative process to determine the best ways to visualize the ecological models and their uncertainty under both sea level rise scenarios and alternative restoration. Next slide, please. This project will strengthen the Everglades restoration project planning by incorporating a key uncertainty in restoration planning success into the planning process. So it's important to determine whether the Everglades ecological integrity is going to remain stable or improve through these synergistic effects of sea level rise and restoration efforts. And just an additional thought, the Everglades restoration community has been a leader in influencing restoration efforts around the world. And so because other restoration projects look to the Everglades for ideas on how to address their own complicated planning and evaluation processes, this project will have broad impact on restoration science as a whole. And that's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you. More exciting work. Thanks for giving us that overview. Next, we have Dr. Jennifer Cartwright from U.S. Geological Survey introducing a project on climate impacts to southeastern rare plants.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. So as many of you are no doubt familiar, the southeast is a region that's rich in biodiversity for many different types of species and taxonomic groups, and that certainly includes plants. We have in our region many rare and threatened and endangered plant species, and many of them are confined to particular specific habitats such as longleaf pine, grasslands, different glade and barren communities, wetlands, and in the Appalachian high elevation communities as well. So there has been an exciting recent effort to produce a regional list of species of greatest conservation need for plants in the Southeast. And it's been led by teams of botanists and experts across the region, coordinated by the Southeast Plant Conservation Alliance, the Atlanta Botanical Garden, NatureServe, and others, to create this list that will be published soon of regional species of greatest conservation need for the whole Southeast. This resource is going to be important for a variety of different applications. One is that many Southeastern states are going to be working on or are already working on revisions to their state wildlife action plans for 2025. And we know that many states are planning to include plant species on their lists of species of greatest conservation need for the first time. So this list could be an important resource for that. We know that, of course, many species have distributions that cross state lines, and that's certainly true for plants as well. So having regional information is helpful to support and facilitate those cross-state partnerships for plant conservation. This regional list of species of greatest conservation need for the Southeast is actually going to be the first in the nation, and there's a hope that it can be a model for similar efforts across the country. Now, we know that state SWAP coordinators, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and others who are working in the space of rare plant conservation have expressed a really strong need for information on climate impacts. So the goal of this project is to produce user-friendly summaries on climate change impacts for subsets of species and habitats from this forthcoming list of regional species of greatest conservation need. That involves integrating downscale climate models with ecosystem and habitat level information, as well as species level information such as plant physiology thresholds, to produce integrated assessments for how climate change may impact rare plant species throughout the Southeast. The project's going to work at both the level of species and ecosystems. So at the level of species, there's an effort to collate information on existing climate vulnerability assessments, such as climate niche models or index-based assessments, such as the NatureServe CCVI that may already exist for species. Condensing all of that information into a single resource can make it much more accessible and helpful for a variety of applications toward plant conservation. And it provides really a value-added, richer set of information for this forthcoming regional SGCN list. It will also flag which species currently lack existing climate change assessments. And so species that don't have climate change vulnerability assessments that have been identified as being of greatest conservation need might be priorities for future assessments. At the level of ecosystems and habitats, there's a plan to integrate climate projections along with habitat information for ecosystems that support relatively large numbers of rare plant species. Those are sort of biodiversity hotspots for southeastern rare plants. So the postdoc on this project is actually starting tomorrow. So that's exciting. And yeah, we're excited to provide this information to support conservation of rare plants across the Southeast.
Thank you, Dr. Cartwright. Very exciting. Our next presenter is Adam Trando with U.S. Geological Survey, introducing the project titled Advancing Climate Change Adaptation Strategies for Sensitive Amphibian Species in the U.S. Caribbean.
Okay, thanks, Ryan. And these are all super exciting. Jen, love to talk about how we can work together. And I was gonna say too, Rob, we should talk about Southern Appalachian. So let's talk about that soon. So yeah, but this one is the work we're doing in the US Caribbean, alternative title, groggies everywhere, ? So this is work we've advanced over the last 10 years to better understand what are the risks to sensitive amphibian species in the U.S. Caribbean and particularly in Puerto Rico. We have confidence that there's a high risk of drying in this region as the planet warms. The more warming we have, the more drying will occur. So if greenhouse gas emissions are stabilized or reduced, the drying will probably be lessened, but the more we emit, the more drying will probably happen in this region. And that really affects, of course, really moisture-sensitive species like endemic frogs across Puerto Rico. So this portion of the work is to help determine the distribution of the extent of suitable habitat into the future for several at-risk species of this genus called Leuthrodactylus. One of them is which is a listed endangered species in Puerto Rico. And so we will be conducting occupancy modeling or occupancy sampling and modeling of where these frogs like to live now. And then we're also conducting laboratory experiments to see, to understand where might they be able to live in the future as the planet warms and as the moisture changes. And we're also deploying new meteorological sensors to better understand local microhabitat conditions that then we can tie more directly to the high resolution climate modeling that we have conducted so far with a past CCASC funded project. And so this becomes directly translatable into adaptive management or adaptation strategies for our partners, in particular, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Puerto Rico, Department of Natural Resources, and other NGOs, as they're trying to understand what are the different types of strategies that will work best in the future to give these species the best chance of persisting through time. So the PIs on this project are Jaime Collazo with the North Carolina Cooperative Research Unit, myself, Dr. Mitch Eaton, who you've already heard from Aaron, Eloy Martinez, Dr. Eloy Martinez at Eastern Illinois University, Dr. Alberto Puente at University of Puerto Rico, Mayaguez, and Dr. Kathy Dello with the North Carolina State Climate Office, who we're really excited to be partnering with all these, this sort of wide group of scientists. And then we have our partners across the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and the Florida Water Science Center and the Army Initiative through USGS. So that's what we're doing. I'm happy to discuss that in more detail with any of you. This has been a really great ongoing project, and we're really thankful for the ongoing support we've gotten from CCASC for really the last 10 years to continue on this sort of long-term research effort to get into climate adaptation and resilient or strategies in the future. Thanks, Ryan.
Thank you. And then finally, we have now Dr. Skylar Hopkins from NC State University introducing her project titled Developing a Cave Conservation Management Toolbox by Exploring Cave Microclimates and Biodiversity Patterns.
Awesome. Thanks, Ryan. Thanks, everyone. So glad to be here today. Really excited to share our efforts to develop this cave conservation management toolbox. So though often overlooked, the southeastern United States has abundant and important karst resources, which are indicated by the colors here on this map. And Puerto Rico and Florida aren't on the map, but they have caves too. And these resources are important to a variety of stakeholders for a variety of reasons. So for example, they provide critical habitat for biodiversity, including endangered species and species that provide important ecosystem services. They provide critical groundwater storage, and they provide recreation opportunities for thousands and thousands of people, which also generates revenue through ecotourism. And these resources are also managed by a variety of organizations or individuals. So for example, there are federal agencies like the National Forest Service, which manage caves on their lands. There are various state agencies like state parks or departments of natural resources that manage caves more locally. There are NGOs that manage caves at the national, regional, or state levels, depending on the size and reach of those organizations. And then there are also lots of private cave owners who have maybe one or a few caves under their care, and they often work in concert with government or non-government organizations. And when we look across space, we know that average above-ground climates affect average below-ground climates, and that weather events like rain impact conditions underground, like stream flow. And all that suggests that climate change is going to alter cave ecosystems, like on average, but there's been relatively little work to understand how exactly things will change and when and where we'll see those changes. And this is in part due to the limited availability of high accuracy microclimate data from caves. When we surveyed key managers prior to the start of this project, we found that none of them were explicitly managing for climate resilience in cave ecosystems. And you know, many told us that climate resilience was important to their organization, but they just didn't know what they could do to improve climate resilience. And then others reported that climate resilience wasn't something that they're prioritizing because they had other demands on their time and resources, but that they'd be open to ideas about how to incorporate climate resilience management strategies if that could fit into what they were already doing. And we also know that there are various management activities that do affect cave microclimates, even if that wasn't the goal. So for example, we know that installing gates to regulate cave access can change airflow and cave temperatures. We know that when people visit caves, especially in large numbers, they affect cave temperatures. And then when land use changes over caves, it can affect temperature via changes to solar radiation or humidity and water levels through changes to runoff and percolation. So the goal of this project is to collect and synthesize data that can aid management decisions. And so for data collection, we're surveying microclimates in 60 caves across the Southeast. For biodiversity, which includes bats, amphibians, and invertebrates, we're surveying a subset of 30 of those caves. And we'll be identifying whether particularly cool and wet caves have distinct biological communities, which could be important targets for management to conserve thermal refugia. We'll also be quantifying how surface and subterranean geography and geology affect cave microclimates, such as getting a detailed picture of how forest cover over caves can mediate cave temperatures and humidity. And then we're going to use these data and then also data from prior studies to create a management toolbox that summarizes what's known about how various management strategies influence or could influence cave microclimates and biodiversity. So our academic team is composed of me and my lab at NC State and then my co-PI, Matt Nymiller, and his lab at the University of Alabama in Huntsville. And depending on how you slice things, we're collaborating with about 16 partner organizations who manage caves in the Southeast. And that includes federal and state agencies and NGOs. And then together, these partners manage hundreds of caves, if not thousands of caves. So to recap, cave managers are open to this idea of trying to manage for climate resilience, but it's unclear how to do that. And so by surveying caves across the region and compiling existing data, we're going to evaluate some potential management options. It's really the first best set of tools for our partners to consider. And this project will also hopefully establish baseline data for our partners and pave the way for new monitoring and evaluation programs for conserving cave ecosystems. So yeah, please feel free to visit our page and email me if you have any thoughts or questions for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hopkins. And thanks to everyone. These are some really exciting projects and just some great presentations that we've had so far to introduce these projects that you're getting spun up now. So we have some time for questions now. You can direct those questions to any of the project PIs about any of the projects. If you want to ask a question, you can raise your hand in the participant box that Carrie highlighted earlier, and we'll call on you to unmute yourself to ask your question. Or you can type your question into the chat box and we'll share it with the group for you ourselves. So thanks again to all of the presenters, and encourage anyone with questions to please raise your hand or put it in the chat box.
Yeah, great. So we've got all of our presenters back on. Simeon and Adam, if you guys want to turn on your video so you can field questions that are sure to come your way, that'd be great. Thanks. Well, I will call out a question or a comment that Terry Radcliffe indicated appreciation for Jennifer Cartwright's support and contribution to the Southeast Plants regional species of greatest conservation need and moving it forward with this project. So yeah, we're glad to have that as one part of our portfolio for sure.
I have a question for Skylar, unless there's someone else who's typed something.
There's nothing that's coming into the chat, so go ahead.
Yeah, I'm curious, how is it difficult, and maybe how difficult is it to get interest in cave conservation? Not many people know about caves. They probably don't know anything about ecology of them, just the general public. And I'm thinking, like with the Everglades, just for the longest while, people thought of it as this swamp that you dump stuff in. Uh-huh. And then it took this kind of, state change to realize it's an ecosystem. And I'm wondering if you had any thoughts about that.
Yeah, if you've ever been to like a pit cave, people often think of those as places to dump things in. I've definitely tried to crawl over decades of trash while getting into caves before. So yeah, I think it depends a little bit on the landowners or nearby people. So you think, lots of people realize that their groundwater is flowing through a cave, right? So they're very interested in like, what is happening to that groundwater when it's under there? Where is that coming from? Or, maybe they want to put in a well and it would have to like go through a cave. So I think those stakeholders are like quite aware. I think we get a lot of other people being interested because lots of bats hibernate in caves. So most of our partners, their highest priority is bat conservation. And then, the public is very interested in what's happening to bats. And then again, there are like thousands and thousands of people who visit caves recreationally. And so they're very aware of cave conservation issues and the ability to access caves and preserve caves for the future. But I say, there's also just a lot of confusion about caves in the general public or just lack of awareness. Certainly if you tell people that, you are interested in, going underground and measuring temperatures and seeing what's happening under there, most people are like, that sounds terrible. And I don't want to do that, right? So there's a lot of, just lack of knowledge or a dislike of that idea in the general public.
Yeah, thank you. And I applaud you for your bravery.
Oh, it's very fun. I'll take any of you underground anytime. Just let me know.
Well, I have a question for the PIs. So much of what the CCASC and the research that we've been investing in over the past decade has really been focused on management challenges. But there's also some really neat science that comes out of these questions. And so for any of you that would like to share, what's one scientific question you're hoping to answer or scientific hypothesis you're really hoping to test with your project?
I'll go ahead and share because mine was actually included in it. One is the point at which we let go of some of our heritage resources, right? So how do we do that in a way that at the same time upholds communities' connections to these places? And I think one of the things that I'm curious to know is how communities feel adaptation strategies that could be put in place, including things like digitization of historic districts as an adaptation strategy to preserve the memory of them and to enhance intergenerational connections to the place and history of that place. So I'm curious to see how that ends up in this project.
Yes, I can go. I'm traditionally a disease ecologist, so I'm really interested in the processes that drive transmission and disease outcomes in wildlife. And there's really a terrible pathogen that's spread across the eastern United States, known to the western United States, called white-nose syndrome. It infects bats while they're hibernating. And we really realized that temperature was really important when we were studying this disease because bats that are roosting in relatively warm places have higher fungal growth rates on their bodies, so they experience more pathology. They're more likely to die from the disease. So we know that that's true, but then we can't really predict which caves are going to be worse from bats because you just don't have temperature data, right? From across the region, it's really hard to know where are we going to see these really strong disease outcomes that are temperature related. We also expect that there's really strong relationships with humidity. So sort of a knock-on from this project, you know, by having widespread microclimate data, we're hoping that we might be able to predict a little bit more about, you know, places that are good for bats and places that might actually be like traps for bats, where roosting there in the winter means they're going to have really high disease-related mortality.
You can go next. Something I'm really excited about is improving our understanding of where, like, what makes good breeding bird habitat. So say like cerulean warblers, we have a pretty good sense that they need like vertical heterogeneity in the structure of the forest. But going out and like measuring that in the field, doing point counts for birds, and then using a LAI meter on a stick to measure the vertical structure, like, it's so labor intensive and expensive. And so I'm excited if we can use like satellite remote sensing as a tool, combined with really distributed like citizen science data or collected point counts, historical point counts, to just try and get a huge sample size of forest structure and bird occupancy. And then that just gives you so much data to cross that with management history, disturbance history, climate, and just a ton of power to answer some cool questions about where birds are.
Quiet crowd today. Anybody online have some questions they wanted to propose? Any particular PIs? Like Georgina, unmute yourself and go ahead. Nope.
There you go. I think at some point I was clapping. I was aiming to raise my hand. I'm also clapping because all the projects that you guys shared with us today are fantastic. I'm super excited to see where you take all of these wonderful ideas. But one common denominator, and I know that this is also because of the funding institution, but it's partnerships. You're all building these excellent projects on very strong partnerships. So my question, and I guess Simeon and Skylar, wow, your network of partnerships and stakeholders were outstanding. It was really impressive. My question is, roughly for each one of you, or if a couple of you can share, what portion of your effort for this project are you assigning to that direct involvement with either stakeholders or partnerships?
I guess I can say it varies on a partner-to-partner basis for our work. So in some cases, like, our partners want to go underground with us and do the surveys with us and deploy loggers with us. Maybe they even are going to deploy loggers for us. We won't even go to their cave. They're going to do that on our behalf. And other people are not going to do that, right? They're going to help us with permitting, and they're going to join our partner summits and let us know about their priorities and things like that. But they won't really help with the data collection and analysis sides of things. It's quite variable from partner to partner.
Yeah, thanks for the question, Georgina. Good work coming up with something on the spot. Our project really kind of stems from the Sustainable Rivers Program, which is an ongoing program that the Army Corps and the Nature Conservancy have. And our project's interesting because the decision makers are also the scientists at the same time. So we have to partition the roles. And so that's kind of my job, to make sure they remind them which role they're taking at any given time. And then the stakeholders just kind of fall out of that. The Roanoke River, there's been decades of work there. So I've kind of lucked out to be brought into this project and with an already established stakeholder network. Your question is how much of the effort is partitioned? I think mine's nearly 100%, and I'm probably about a third of the effort. So it would be stakeholder structure decision making, one third, modeling, one third. And then the other third is kind of like data ground truthing, data wrangling type of stuff. Does that answer your question?
Yes, I would have assumed that roughly there is at least 25% of any one of your projects that is considered like you're having that big engagement component. So yes, from the entire project effort, about 25% of it, it's engagement. So you said one third, that's roughly more than that. Makes sense. Your network is pretty wide. So yeah, that's sort of what I was going. Thank you both for sharing.
Yeah, thanks for that question, Georgina. And I think that that is one of the tenets of how the CCASC operates, and building that stakeholder interaction through the whole course of a project is one that we like to encourage. So, and how best to then get those results to those stakeholders at the end of the is something that we try to focus on as well. So Brittany, if you want to start sharing, well, first off, I want to say thanks very much to all of you for these really great introductions. And as an opportunity to sort of roll out to the world some of this great work that's been kicked off. So hope that everyone online will continue to follow the progress of these, and most easily probably through our newsletter, which we try to promote some of the outcomes of some of these projects as they move along. But I wanted to wrap up then, well, first off, I want to say again, a huge thank you. And then wrap up with letting you know about some other things that are coming up here from the Southeast Climate Adaptation Science Center. So we have a couple of other seminars coming up, one this month, organized by our Global Change Fellows, Sam, who is now a postdoc with Rob Scheller, was one of our fellows, as Rob mentioned, and so he got to help organize some of these seminars during his tenure with us. So they've organized this great seminar about inclusivity in the outdoors with, and it will be both be a hybrid event. So if you're on campus, join us in David Clark Labs room 101 on the 23rd, or if you can't be there, join us by Zoom. And we'll put in the, I think Kristen's just put into the chat the registration for that. So feel free to join that. And it will, again, be recorded and posted if you can't make it then. So, and then we will be, our next science seminar that's organized by staff here at the Southeast CASC will be given by Dr. Catherine Kasha Nikel, on the subject of climate support for species status assessments. So she's going to give us information about how those projects and there are several are organized in the Southeast CASC. So we'll look forward to that. So, and I think we have the registration in the chat for that. So, and then finally, by registering for this webinar, we're gonna add you to our mailing list if you aren't already. Hope that you'll stay on the mailing list to receive our monthly newsletters. We don't spam you. We really try to treat that rather gingerly, and of course you're welcome to unsubscribe. So again, thanks to people for joining us. Thanks especially to our presenters. And hope you all have a good rest of your day. Take care, y'all.